Welcome to Silica Boots Podcast, and we are back with another episode. The wonderful lady here is our guest, model, a lawyer, an attorney student, if I'm not wrong, a lawyer in the making. The reason why I invited her, because she had gone through a very interesting journey, I would say. Some would find it inspirational, others won't. We will talk about that. It is all out there in the open on her Instagram, how she's been to what she's been through to get where she is. What we are going to talk about is this, what happens between those stories. So without further ado, I introduce you, Nimisha. Thank you very much for taking your time out. Welcome to the podcast.
Hello. Yes, thank you so much for having me. I'm really excited.
Thank you. This podcast, it's like I'm walking on a landmine, you know. I don't know where and whom I'm going to offend with wrong words, but let me put it this way.
Yeah.
Yes, so you were not like this a year ago. You were looking much bigger. You were weighing around 80 odd kilos. Now you have come down to 59 kilos. And that's a
59.
Within 1 year, right? So we'll talk about the journey, but you know, have you ever heard about people who come back to you saying, some come back to you saying it's inspirational, some come back to you saying you are glamorizing, or what can we say? Glorifying is the word. You're glorifying weight loss journey. That's something that not everyone can take. So why are we doing this podcast? Are we glorifying your weight loss journey, or what are we doing here?
So let me begin by telling, I used to weigh 86.5 kilograms. As of May, 30th of May, the last day of May, that's how much I weighed. Right. And from June is when I started, I realized on that day that I have to change something in my life. I couldn't continue this way. And that's how the journey started. Now, coming to your question of whether we are going to glorify weight loss, the answer to that is no. And like you said, this whole topic is it's a landmine. You are going to offend somebody at the end of this episode.
We are
going to offend But what I want to say is to people who's looking to change their life for better, obviously, you should start your fitness journey if you feel like it. Don't listen to others. There are always people telling you you could look better this way, you could look better that way. And I will come, as the conversation goes on, I will come to the instances of what I still receive, what I still hear from people, in spite of what some people define as a supermodel body. I still get things said to me. So my answer to that is, let's not glorify. Let me just say, you start your journey for a better life if you think you should do it. Don't listen to what other people has to say. So yeah, that's the answer for that one. But like you said, we are probably going to piss off somebody.
Yeah, I think the point you're trying to say is that you should decide what makes your life better. You know, for some,
yes,
slimming down makes their life better. For some, you know, staying where they are or probably putting up a little more makes life better for them. So it's totally up to you, and nothing should be glorified and nothing should be shamed, regardless of what the choice of the person is, guy or a girl. And there is a little more drama with the girl, you know, how society adds to it. Right?
Exactly.
Extra. We'll get into that. But in this era of body positivity, right? So you were supposed to feel positive about your body, right? So why did you feel the other way? And why did you feel like you wanted to go down, you know, especially in 2020? And 2020 is, we are into the woke era. So, you know, why not just be positive about your body and just keep it as it is?
So in the era of body positivity, if you have been following me for a long time, you know, I've always been positive. I have, now that I've been on both sides of the weight spectrum, most of my life, I was on the heavier side, right? So I was very confident of the way I looked. So that's the reason, like, it was never about how you looked. And that is why I have to say, we are not trying to glorify you or make you feel bad into losing weight, or we are not trying to make you feel bad for being a certain weight. That is why I always say it's your choice. Do you think you should lose weight or do you think you should gain weight? So for me, like everybody else, when the pandemic struck, it was such an unprecedented event. A lot with the pandemic and staying at home came a lot of time and a lot of watching television, not moving out much. Like when I had classes, when I was in law school, there was a lot of traveling involved and running through stairs and, you know, running about in the college. But all of a sudden that came to a halt and I found myself not moving much at all. And in the span of 2 months, so from May, from March, I was sitting at home. By the end of May, I had put on an additional 6.5 kgs. Mm-hmm. And that was the highest I weighed at 86.5. Not to tell that I felt any less of myself. I was the same sassy bitch at 80. And I am the same now. Like but at 86.5, I felt a lot tired. I felt my mental health was taking a big dip. And a lot of that had to do with the life that I was getting accustomed to, like being at home, just not having too many people to talk. And it was taking a big toll on my mental health. So that's when I decided, see, I have to change something. So it was never about just the weight. It was, I wanted to feel better. And I was so afraid to fall back to a place where I cannot come back, because I was somebody who has suffered from depression earlier, and it did not do good. And I do not ever want to go back to that place again. But during the time of quarantine, the first 3 months, when I was just binge eating and I was just watching hours upon hours of television, because we didn't have much to do. Like, what can you do at home? Like, and the classes were not happening as well, because they're also figuring out this new way. The online classes started well later into the pandemic. So that left us with a lot of time and not much to do. So I felt like I was going, I was living the same day over and over again. And that is a kind, that is a feeling that was so familiar to me, and I was so afraid to fall back to that place again. So I had to change something up. And I thought, okay, maybe this is when I will, you know, slowly start incorporating things, like maybe walk in my terrace, like get some sunlight first, because I was sleeping at like 4 a.m. and 5 a.m. and waking well in the afternoon. So
classic pandemic sleep cycle.
The sleep slowly and wake up early, and let's, you know, make some small changes so that I stopped feeling the way I felt then. And but the trigger, the big push happened when one of my girlfriends, we are friends from school. So she called up one day, video called me and said, you know, she's getting married. And I was like, oh my God, so exciting. So she said she'll get married by the end of the year. So December 2020. And that day after the call, I looked myself in the mirror and I was like, okay, you have a wedding to attend. Now we are not stuck. Like, we are not going to be stuck in this house forever. So you have a wedding to attend. And I was like, okay, let's like take, even though before that, I started slowly changing my sleep schedule and trying to move around much. But that one thing really pushed me. But it's not just the attending. I never attended her wedding, by the way.
Okay.
So, but that something was the helped. One. I know. Like, so, and she was supposed to get married in December. By December, I was hot. So she pushed the wedding later on. That's not my problem. So I was...
You were hot regardless of the weight, though. But that is the point of body positivity, right? So because it's not about, one should not also, you know, there are people who are like, you're encouraging laziness and all that. To them, I say that, dude, there is literally data out there which says that overweight people, you know, lose job opportunities sometimes, you know, and they get diagnosed for wrong things. Like, everything that's there internally in their body, it's put on weight and the actual issue is ignored by the doctor. You know, that is where actually body positivity is needed, and that cannot be ignored, right?
See, I feel like there's a thin line between body positivity and encouraging such behavior. Like some people will be like, I'll eat whatever I want. Yes, you do. But there is data that says that, you know, obese people live much lesser, much shorter than people who are not obese. And my question is, why would you want to live less? Like, why would you want to make your love? Why would you not want to be there for your loved ones? Why would you, if you can change? Now, see, this is again, like I said, very, very controversial territory we are entering now. There are people who with medical conditions. Now, we can't just look at them and like, why can't you lose weight? That's a very rude thing to say. So for that, yeah, I understand people. And a lot of people think that when I put up workout posts, they feel bad. And I've put a story on this as well. I was very clear. I told that if you feel any less about yourself, if you look at my story and feel, oh my God, I'm so worthless, you should unfollow me. Because that is not the intention here. But the intention is to, if you were thinking about working out today, and you were like, maybe tomorrow, but you see my post and be like, you know what? Today is the day, and you do it. That's good. But there are people with medical conditions who cannot work out. Like, they can't do the kind of lifting I do. So I don't want you to feel bad for that. So there is a lot of gray areas in this body positivity versus encouraging people to, overeat and stuff. Like, I remember watching one YouTube video where this really obese person was chugging in chicken nuggets or something. A lot of food. Now, that is, I don't know. That is an unhealthy amount of food.
Yeah, it's not shaming. It's like if you know a friend who's smoking, it's not like you're assassinating on that friend's character. Yeah. It's just like, dude, just it's unhealthy. Just stop doing it.
Don't die. So, like, yeah. Why would you want to, like, not, I mean, yeah, be there for your family?
If that's your choice, that's a different story. I mean, either you make an informed choice or, you know, you don't have to feel really ashamed of the way you live. Right? So,
but body positivity, I am all for body positivity. Yeah. If you are, that is why I said you is the word that you need to stress here.
What do you
want? You are comfortable. Yeah. What do you want? If you want this, yes. But I will never encourage people like eating, you know, 300 chicken nuggets and calling it body positivity. No, that is straight up not body positivity. That is an unhealthy amount of chicken nuggets for a person to be eating in one meal.
Sure.
Portion control, people. Like, eat it over 3 days.
Yeah. But were there any myths when you, which you discovered, which you thought were like completely something else, and then you went through that and you're like, this is not what I thought it is, right? So what are the myths and the you know, wrong impressions that you had that got corrected while you were on this journey? If you stop working out, do you start gaining weight, or like all these myths, right? So what did you discover exactly in your journey?
See, the biggest turning point for me was this time around. See, this is not the first time I'm trying to lose weight, by the way, but this is the first time I was successful. Remember this, especially about food, okay? You can't eat chicken. Chicken makes you fat. No, chicken's protein. I eat chicken every day for every meal. And they're like, don't eat egg yolk, that's fat. No, it's delicious. It has a lot of micronutrients and it will keep you satiated. So a lot of myths got busted when I did my research on food, especially. And this, again, took hours upon hours of research. But I did it because, like I said, there was so much time in my hand. But I mean, if you don't have that kind of a time, that's when you approach like a professional, like a dietitian or, a personal trainer or something. But with food is when I discovered a lot of myths being busted. Like, ghee makes you fat. No, ghee is fat, but healthy fats are so essential.
What makes you fat is that KFC fat that's frying in that pan. That is what it is.
Yeah, oil, I would suggest. Yep. Oil is one thing that I don't, it's not healthy. Like, no, I bake my chicken. Like, I don't deep fry them. I'm like, no, I'm not wasting my calories on those oil.
Interesting.
No, but healthy fats are really important. Like egg yolks. I've seen people eat just egg whites and be like, no, egg white is protein. Yes, it is protein. egg yolk is fat. But healthy fats are so important for you because fat is the one that keeps you satiated for a longer time, or else you feel hungry really quick. Yep. So, and ghee, and butter, cheese, people say you should stay away from all this. No, they are healthy. You have to incorporate them in your diet. Extra calories makes you fat, not the egg yolks or not chicken alone. That doesn't make you fat. The extra amount of calories, anything which goes above, you know, your moderation level will make you fat. So what you have to do is find the balance.
Any other myths?
So that's, sleeping in the afternoon makes you fat. No. I take a nap every afternoon, and I take my nap very seriously. Okay. Like the world can end, but I will still take my nap time because otherwise I'm a very grumpy person by evening. So I need my afternoon naps. And I've lost all this weight taking naps every single day from when I'm sitting in quarantine. I'm dreading of the day when I have to go back to real world and I can't take my nap again. I'm like, oh God, that is a life. I don't know how I will survive. But you should take, I mean, you could take naps. But just because you nap, you're not going to put on weight.
The most important myth is that, boom, this is a twist, and probably people who know you on the Instagram know this, but you have completely worked out at your home, isn't it?
I
don't think you have
you
seen the face
of... You need a gym to lose weight.
Yeah, I don't think you have seen the face of a gym ever. Even though the gyms were open, I guess, if I'm not wrong. So talk about that for a second.
I will get to that. Yeah. So, like I said, this is not the first time I'm trying to lose weight, right? So I used to go to the gym like in 2018, but I still weighed around 80-ish kilos. I never lost weight. I just used to go. I used to work out a little bit and come back. I never gave much importance to my nutrition. Honestly, I didn't feel the need to lose weight. I was pretty fine until then. I was very athletic also. I used to play throw ball back in my school, my college. I used to be the team captain. So it was not that I was at 80, I was healthy, even though people had different opinions. I never cared for it. Then I realized that I need to change was during this quarantine when I was getting really lazy and I was starting to feel like, okay, I'm not doing anything. I can't go out and play now. No, I'm having zero physical activity. So I need to change. So in 2018, I used to go to the gym. Nothing much happened. 2019, I joined law school. Then the gym completely stopped because I had no time. So I used to be in college from 9 to 4 and I'm home by 5:30-ish. And then I'm so tired to go to the gym. So that stopped in 2018 itself. So from 2019, no gyms, nothing. Then 2020, pandemic happened, everything closed. So I started working out at home and I have not gone to a gym since. I could. I mean, gyms were open until like April. Then again, they closed down. But I don't think I need to go to a gym now. Like, I'm pretty comfortable because you know why? I don't want to set myself up to failure. Like, I could give an excuse that, you know, I'm tired to travel today and gym is like, you know, 4-5 kilometers away. Let me not go. I am literally in my room. My dumbbells are like 10 feet away from me. There is no excuse I can give for not taking them and starting working out.
Yeah.
So I think I'm good with home workouts. And yeah, that's another myth. You need to go to the gym to lose weight. You absolutely don't need to do that. You can work out at home and lose all that weight.
But
if you want it.
Yeah, that takes a lot of research. And that is where...
Oh, yeah. That is why I said research is so important. And I think that's where I won. Like, I really, really won in my research category because... If I just started off without any research and I did not see results, no, I would have given up. I'll be like, I've been doing this for 2 months and this is not happening. But I was so confident that this time it will work because I was sure. I read so many research papers. I read so much about nutrition, about workouts. And I spent around 2 months trying on different workouts to see what I enjoyed doing the most. Because then again, I don't want to set myself up to failure by forcing me to do a workout that I don't enjoy. So there was no way I would have lost all that weight if I was asked to do like Pilates. I don't like Pilates. I don't enjoy them. They are so painful. I envy people who do Pilates. I'm like, how are you doing this? I can't do calisthenics. I for my life of it, I can't do it. I hate cardio.
Interesting.
No.
So yeah, wait. Wait. You don't do much of a cardio. Another myth. I was coming to that. So you never did cardio and you still...
Let me not say never, okay? I will give you the split. It's an 80-20 split. 80% of the time I stuck to strength training and 20% of the time I pushed to do cardio during my weight loss. Now that I'm in maintenance weight, I don't do much cardio at all. Like, wow. I try and increase my heart rate, like, for a little while, but I do not do cardio at all because I hate it. I know if it is a cardio day, I will find every excuse under this planet to not do it. So why am I forcing myself? And there are research that say that strength muscles take a lot more calories to maintain.
Yeah.
So strength training is better in the long run. So if you train now, yes, you are spending a lot less calories because your heart rate is not fluctuating as much as it would in when you do cardio, right?
Mm.
So when you're strength training, initially, the initial investment wise, you are losing a lot less calories. Your initial weight loss will be very less. But let's look at the larger picture here. In the long run, all those muscles you've been building, it's going to take a lot more calories to maintain. So if you are very consistent with your diet, your body is going to tap into your fat reserve for that extra difference. So you are going to lose weight. So if you look at my progress pictures also, from June until December, there was difference, but not much. But all of a sudden, from December till now, there's a huge change. That is because of all the muscles that I have been building all this while. It was a waiting game. It is a very, very long waiting game.
Sure.
So, yeah, I don't enjoy it. The bottom line of all this is I don't enjoy cardio, and I will do everything in my power to not do it.
One myth. But, yep, one myth that absolutely doesn't work is that, I'm sorry, which is it, one myth that should not be considered as a myth is science works, okay? And even when it comes to exercising and weight loss, science absolutely works.
It's an equation.
Yep.
The minute you crack it, no, your weight will fall like this.
Exactly.
And that is why I feel like people who want to go through this again, invest most of your time in doing your research or like getting that help from a really, really qualified person. Okay. There are so many being like internet famous. Now that I have like 12,000 followers, I have hundreds of personal trainers that follow me. And sometimes they're like, my client lost 10 kgs in 2 months. That is not healthy. And the minute you would have put them in a really caloric deficit diet, which made them lose 10 kgs, but the minute they start eating properly, all the weight is going to come back. So it's gradual, it's slow and steady. It is science, it is an equation. I'm telling you, the minute you crack that equation, your weight will fall off and you wouldn't even realize that, you know, oh my God, I'm not even... Sometimes I'll be like, what did I even do for all this weight to go? But it's the planning, it's the calculation. Science definitely works. It is science.
That is two ways of doing this. Either you teach yourself or, you know, meet the best expert. But, you know, science works even in the weight loss thing. But coming to your changes, right? So did anything in you change as a person when you lost all this weight? So were you a different person back then? Extra confidence, lesser confidence, mental health?
Mental health wise, I feel like I am at my best now.
We can see that.
So, you know, I feel like I'm winning at things for once. The confidence wise also, not that I was any less confident. If people know me from before the weight loss, you know, I was a savage then, I'm a savage now. I will continue to be a savage no matter how much I weigh.
Sure.
But walking into a room, oh my God, like the way I walk, people have told me that the way you walk itself, like there's this aura around you that's like, people are, they're like, we can't take our eyes off you. So I think that's to listen to all of this.
Yeah.
That's really confident. It boosts my confidence. And secondly.
So this never happened back then. Is that what you're trying to say?
No.
Really?
I mean, not. I used to be, obviously, I am this textbook extrovert. Okay. So I'm always like the loudest. And, you know, I always get along with people all the time. So that's not the thing. But now, even people who don't know me, like I've gone to the airport, like say 4 or 5 times over the last few months, people just turn back and look. And I don't know why. But that it boosts your confidence. Let's be real. It does boost your confidence because you put all that time and effort to this, and now these what I'm receiving now is delayed gratification. You can say because when I was going through, nobody was there. Like it was just me stuck in my house doing all this. My friends couldn't see. There was nobody to tell me, you know, oh, you're doing a good job. So I was my biggest cheerleader, but now people around me are always telling me good things. Most of the times.
Which is kind of unfortunate, right? It does boost your confidence, but it is kind of unfortunate, isn't it? But you know, what was this person that they didn't discover before you were looking a certain way, you know?
But let's be real about the, if I have to be real about this, people do notice you a lot more. Maybe because you look a certain way or because you did something so spectacular. Mm-hmm. Like they're really like shocked or like they're surprised that you did it. So right now, of course, like a lot of my Instagram should be the biggest example for that. I used to have 2000 followers. I think when you followed me, I had like 2000, 3000 followers.
Yeah. And then we'll talk about that matter of months.
Yeah.
Few more thousand.
Matter of months. It shot up. So people, I think, are attracted to people who have done certain things. It's unfortunate, really unfortunate.
Yeah.
I have to be honest. I will tell you about this incident in the airport, okay? And when we talk about Instagram, we'll get there. Again, very unfortunate, but what can you do? Like
That was my next question, actually. So did people around you change the way they treat you, the friends, the family, the relatives? So tell me about the people, the professors, and you know, there must be some change over there, for sure.
Let's begin with family. I don't know if this is the Indian family thing or if my family is like this. They always have something to complain about, okay? Earlier it was I was too fat. Now I am too thin. So, that is why I am basically a Malayali. So, my parents are from Kerala, Thrissur. I was born and raised in Bengaluru, but my native is Kerala, right? So the last time I went was in 2017.
Okay.
Because that is the time I decided I will never put myself through this, because casual body shaming is so normalized in amongst this family and relatives. They tell things like, oh, you should lose weight, okay, or else nobody will marry you. Did I ask you? No, right? So last in 2017, I decided, you know what, I'm not going to put myself through this, and I've never gone back to my native, and I wish to keep it that way unless there's like an emergency that requires me to go. Now I look absolutely like different, right? Even if I go now, people will be like, oh my God, you've become so thin. Why are you not eating? So I know this, and when my grandparents call me, they'll be like, only your teeth are left. I can see your collarbones. Yeah, seriously, okay. These are the things I hear casual. On a daily basis. And it's so normalized. They don't think it's wrong at all. And that's the sad part of it. So what I can do is, I realized really early on that you can't change, especially when it comes to family.
Elders.
You can't change some people. Yeah, elders. So what you can do is remove yourself from the situation. I stopped going to my native. Every time they call, I'll be like, next time I'll come. That next time never arrives. I go to every place surrounding my home, but I never go home.
Okay.
So even my parents, through the journey, in the beginning of the journey, I remember my parents telling, don't do all this. It will not work. And then through the journey, they're like, yeah, you're losing weight. And when I hit around 65 kgs, they were like, you should stop now. I'm like, it's my choice. Like, I have a goal in my mind. And let me reach there. And then it will be maintenance. Now they're telling you're too thin. Now they're like, you're too thin. I hear this all
classic.
The time. So that's how,
fam. That's about fam.
Yeah. Friends, now that's the really good role.
You know what?
Add
dating to that as well, if you would like.
Oh, sure. Yeah. We'll get there. When it came to friends, nobody's been seeing me for a year, right? So we're all stuck at our homes from March of 2020. In April of 2021 is when our college called us back for exams. So that's 1 year and 1 month. people were surprised nevertheless to see me because
classic. Yeah.
This surprise. Yeah, this was not the Nimisha that was
Yeah.
Did I get cut off?
That's fine, you can continue. That's fine.
So this was not the Nimisha that they saw back in March and 2020. And in April 2021, this whole different person walks in. But let me tell you, I felt so proud, like walking there, like looking the way I looked. And I wish there's a huge mirror in our girls' washroom where we used to take pictures. I wish I took a before picture so that I could just, because I took an after picture and I looked so good in it. And I was like, oh my God, I should have taken a before picture so that I could compare it. But anyways, but all my friends in law school were like appreciating the way I look. And they were so proud of me. And they're like, oh my God, Nimisha, you look stunning. So that's good. But I did go through one incident, which is very unfortunate, to be honest. So one of my friends was getting married in January.
Okay.
And we are friends from 10 years. Okay. So we are friends from PU. So after 10th, you have 11th and 12th, right? So that's when we all, the friends group met. So we went for the wedding and obviously we friends group, not all of them, but some of them made it. And that one person who I considered as my best friend amongst girls, like we took a picture and all this while when we were taking pictures and she's like, oh, I don't look good. She's telling about herself. Oh, I don't look good in this. I don't look good in this. So I didn't give it much thought. And then when I came back, so back in January, I have like, 2,000 followers. I'm not this famous. So I don't ask people, like if I'm in a picture, I just put it. But now I would never do that because now there are a lot of people watching my stories. I will always take consent. I'll ask them, you're okay with me putting this picture up as a story. But back then I didn't. And I put the story and we have done this in 10 years. We have done this thousands of times because we are really close. And when I put up that picture, she's like, can you please take it down? I look so fat. I'm like, okay. I immediately took it down. Okay. Even though I didn't tell anything to her, I took it down. I was like, yeah, it's down. But my question is, what about the 10 years that you posted pictures with me when I was the fat one? Like, did I tell anything? But that it didn't matter to me. Like, I was happy then. I was okay then. But I have never heard her say this excuse before that incident. She looks fat. And I would never consider her as fat. She looks fat compared to me now. So that's why she wanted the picture down. So that really hurt me. I never spoke to her after that.
Wow.
She did leave me a text last month. I mean, I fell sick. So she just texted me to say, somebody told me you were sick. And but we never spoke about this. I don't even think she realizes how that comment of hers must have hurt me. But you know, it did. I did feel bad. I'm like, okay, now nobody wants to take pictures with me because I look like this.
Have you had such fat phobic incidences before 2020, for example? So I don't know. You don't want to go back there. That's absolutely fine.
See, there was an incident. I have spoken about this on my stories one day. Really rude. Okay, no human should speak like this to another human. This one person said to me, I would ask you to go hang yourself, but you're too heavy for that.
Okay.
And I don't know what to feel bad in that, like the fact that he just told me to go die or the fact that he told I'm too heavy. But that is something I will never forget in my life. Like that should never. Now I could call him out. Imagine, like with the power that I have now, like calling him out, I could completely destroy. He will never come back on social media again. But I don't want to. I choose not to. I'm like, that's water on the bridge. I'm never. But I don't think anybody should ever hear this from another human being. Like that is just rude.
That is the point body positivity movement, right? It's not as if you're encouraging, you know, unhealthy eating habits. The point is, no matter how one looks, big or small, in this example, that should not decide how much respect that person is going to get, how many opportunities that person is going to get, how differently is going to get diagnosed at a doctor. You know, these everyday life situations should not be any different no matter how much you weigh. That is the point of body positivity. And I don't know why people misunderstand it for, you know, encouraging obesity and encouraging, you know, bad eating habit, which is not the case.
Correct. So that's where body positivity has to work. Mm. Like making like not your, the number on the scale, not deciding your opportunities, your worth, the respect you get from people, the opportunities you have. But yeah, that's where body positivity actually is trying to, you know, bring awareness, but then people just think otherwise. But you always have those kind of people in you. I don't know, especially now that this internet fame has got to me and it's so new, I'm learning that you can't make everybody happy. There will always be somebody who interprets your message in such a way that you've never even thought about. And you can't go on explaining yourself to every single person, because you have to save your energy. As human beings, we have limited amount of energy, and you have to save your energy to do things that matters to you. So sometimes you just have to ignore, and sometimes just move on.
Yeah, and you don't have to shame people who are not choosing this lifestyle, and you don't have to shame people who have chosen this lifestyle, right? It's all, you know, for example, that incident where Adele lost her weight. Did you see that? So people were like, why did she lose her weight? So did she feel bad? She was like, no, I mean, she's not carrying the responsibility of your keeping up with your image, right? So she's going to do what she wants, right? So if she loses weight, she gains weight. She's not supposed to be shamed for that, like questioned for that.
It's her choice. That's why I say it should be you who decide what is best for you. So why you don't want to do it? Yesterday also I had this conversation with one of the people. If you have seen yesterday's story, somebody was like, chubby looks good on you. Did I ask? Like, you know how disrespectful, how offensive it is to tell somebody who spent an entire year working so hard, blood, sweat and tears, to look the way I look now. It's not just a look, to be where I am. So I'm talking about the entire character change, the entire transformation. It's not just the weight. And then you tell me, oh, you look good, better. I didn't ask. Like, did I ask you? No, right? Like, you are entitled to your opinion, but please keep it to yourself unless like somebody asks for it. And what is with these people? And one other person, like me putting up a story of this person telling me that he feels chubby is better. I didn't ask him how he feels. He's like, no, but people are entitled to their opinion, right? If you don't want opinion, you close the reply thing. I'm like, you don't reply. Like, who asked you to reply? Like, did I ask you to reply? Like, something to my story?
Victim shaming, that's all it is. It's just...
Yeah, like, it's so unfortunate. And you can never live up to the expectations of people's idea about you. Like, what people think in their mind about you. That's something you can never keep up. Because everybody has a different thing to say. Like, everybody has a different thing to say. And especially when it comes to weight loss and body, these are really sensitive topics. And I feel, and I say this out loud, do not, unless you have been asked, do not go on giving your opinion, especially if you're not like a professional. Even if you're a professional, I have had professional trainers tell me things. I'm like, I didn't ask you. Like, if I ask you with a lot of respect, I'm telling you, I did not ask you. If I need help, I will reach out. I will tell you something. But don't just come around, you know, commenting on somebody's body. You know, how difficult. You don't know the story about it. Like, what if I am that woman who, let's say, couldn't have a kid because I was so overweight and I tried so hard just so I could have that child. And you come around shaming me, telling, oh, you look good, better when you're fat. You know how bad that must have hurt? Like, people are so insensitive these days. I would never, to be very honest, I never have gone out of my way to like say anything about how somebody looks. Yes, if somebody looks absolutely gorgeous, the only words I use is gorgeous, handsome, fantabulous, all of that. People never see me to go, oh, but you could have you know, you could have lost a little weight. You could have. I would never tell that. But people are not like that. People think it's their right, the entitlement. Yeah. They feel that, you know, just because you put a story, they have to tell something. And even now I get called fat. I put up workouts and I do this. Nobody is paying me for sitting and typing all those workouts, okay? And putting it on my story. I do this because I feel even if it helps one person, that I'm happy. And I get so many emails, like long emails that people have sat and put their thought in and typed and sent, telling how much I motivate them. And that's enough for me. Like, that is more than enough. I don't care what other people have to say. And when I put out the ab workout, there was this very nice person who replied to that telling, you don't even have abs, fatty.
That point, you know, I want to expand on that. People think that, you know, a certain body type can only be a fit body type. As in, you have to have a chiseled body with a six pack and a nice bulging chest, and then you're fit, right? That is another misconception that we have. Whereas people have shown over and over again that, you know, big looking athletes perform no less than the other ones. Take Shaquille O'Neal, for example, all right? Take Rakeem Cornwall in cricket, right? So every weightlifter is basically fat according to these people's standards, right? So, but he's an Olympic athletes. What are you doing, loser? So this idea.
I said the same thing in my story.
This thing about, like, you know, slim, athletic-looking people are the only ones who can be athletic, and who can be the fit. The idea of fit, you know, who is fit and who is not, is just so weird, because anyone can be fit regardless of how many bags they have.
Exactly. And this person who typed this and sent, I'm presuming they're sitting on their lazy ass while they were typing this. Because if they were doing something productive, I don't think you will take that time out of to call somebody else who not only finished her workout, but sat and typed all that workouts to put it as story for no particular, you know, income, and to call that person fatty because, you know, I don't have abs. Why only people with abs would... are supposed to do ab workouts?
And even the presence of abs does not really signify, you know, core strength. You can still have core strength, but, you know, you may not have abs. Like,
yeah. See, that's my case. Like, I still have a lot of, you know, fat, but I can feel my core, like, really, really strong because I work. I really work out really hard. It's okay. And that's how I want it to be. Like, I'm very, very happy where I am right now. I don't want chiseled six-pack abs.
Yeah.
Like, what is this? Like,
that doesn't indicate fitness as well, you know?
Yeah, that's not a sign of fitness. No, and this is so unfortunate. I don't know why people are like this. And it's very unfortunate.
And also, the fact that you had told me that you hate running. You absolutely hate running. Being all this fit, fitness encouraging person, living this lifestyle, you don't run. Doesn't mean you're not fit.
My cardiovascular system is probably not at the best, but I can lift like a beast. But you ask me to run 10 minutes in a treadmill, I will fall down.
Exactly.
The fitness is not this one size fits all that what people think, okay, this person can run this much, can lift this much, has this much visible abs, and only that is fitness, and everything else other than that is unfit. That's so not true. See, footballers, like, they are not like bulky, right?
Yeah.
They are like really slender because they are expected to be agile. Like, they are expected to be fast. Are they not fit? Like, will you last on a football ground like 9 minutes?
I may be wrong, but I can very happily bet that a sumo wrestler is probably fitter than this guy, just because that fellow can throw you around, you know. The idea that, come on, man, Maradona was not exactly the slimmest dude in the world, but he was a magician with the ball, right? So, Inzamamul Haq in cricket. So, you know, this idea that only big people can't be agile, athletic, is just weird, right? So, if that's the case, then there won't be a thing called heavyweight boxing, right? So, so that was one myth I want to talk about. But what do you think, like, the recent Instagram influencers who document their body weight journey, right? So what are they doing wrong? What are the ways that they are being insensitive that you really see around a lot in the internet? And how should you properly document your weight loss journey without, you know, being insensitive to the ones who don't choose to do that journey?
Okay. So one thing I can think of right off the top of my head is when people, especially these fit tubers, I think they're called fit tubers and fitstagrammers or whatever. So these people put out what I eat in a day, right? No. A lot of people are going to follow that and it's not going to help them, because especially when it comes to food, it is mostly decided, the number of calories is mostly decided on your height, your weight, your fitness level. But I don't think people know this as much, and they're just going to try and eat what this really tiny person is eating in a day.
Who's not even a dietitian, by the way.
Yeah. So I feel that is a very problematic content that I am seeing around on YouTube and Instagram. I don't think you will never find me put up what I eat in a day, because it doesn't matter. Like, what I eat in a day is not going to help anybody other than me. So it doesn't have to be there. And internet is a very, very difficult place. And I don't even want to call people dumb, okay? People are just, some people are so desperate to lose weight, they will just blindly follow. And it's sad. People ask me every single day, can you give out diet plans? Can you give your diet plans? It doesn't help anybody. What I eat is for my, I am 5'3" and 59 kgs. I am a tiny person. You might be 90 kgs and a dude who's 6 foot. You can't survive on the food that I eat. You should be eating a lot more. And you should ask, either do your research and, you know, you can do it yourself. That's what I did. Or ask a professional to do it. So this, what I eat in a day content is very, very like problematic, I feel. And then this one I see, this detox teas and slimming teas.
Green tea.
That they're laxative basically, okay? I'm sure, because what the result you might get is when you take a laxative, you get diarrhea basically.
Okay.
And then you lose all the water weight, right? So instantly you will see the 2 to 3 kilograms on the skin. That's not fat. When you say weight loss, you're talking about fat loss, right? So this detox teas and you know, slimming teas, I see some people telling I got my abs, these fit tubers, okay? I'm sure these companies are pumping in a lot of money for this, and these fit tubers are making big bucks, but people, it doesn't work, people. It doesn't work.
And one thing is, people have no patience and time to like explore their own body, right? So what works for their body, what exercise, even exercises are not the same, right? So it's not like I cannot follow your workout routine and you cannot follow mine, right? So
exactly.
I figured out a workout routine and a food routine because I experimented for like 2-3 months to figure like what is working for me. So people don't have patience, and they just, and you know, Instagrammers, they just provide that information in 15 seconds and that's very convenient, and you know, the accuracy goes for a toss basically.
And people, agreeing to your point, like people not having patience, people want fast results. They don't understand that this is like a marathon, this is not a sprint, like it's a waiting game, it's a long journey. You should have a goal of what I see, like where I see myself in the next 6 months, 10 months, 1 year. But people work out for 2 weeks and they come back and they tell me, I worked out 2 weeks, but I didn't lose any weight. Be patient. Be patient. Like, your body is learning. It's relearning. It's learning how to tap into your fat to, you know, use it. It's going to take time.
Yeah.
Be kind to your body. Don't beat it up so much. And people will be like, I work out 3 times a day. Why? Why?
Yeah. Rest is as important. And the thing is,
recovery is so important. Like, muscle recovery is so important. You do that for 3 days and on 4th day, you are completely sore. And then you don't work out on 5th day and 6th day. And then you lose it. And what is the point?
Yeah.
You rather work out like half an hour every day, or like 5 days a week, instead of doing this 2-3 hours stunt on 3 days and then not working the rest of the week.
Yeah. For example, when I joined the gym newly, I just straight away was going on and pumping some squats with a lot of weight. And then, you know, a gym trainer came to me and told me that, like, dude, your posture is so wrong sitting all these days in an IT chair for like 6 years. First of all, you have to really spend at least 3 months correcting your posture, your backbone, your shoulders, to, you know, at least get the body straight. You do squats with this posture, you're going to get arthritis, right? And you lose your disc. We very conveniently skip the small little things that we miss, right? Having a strong internal rotation, we miss, you know, having a posture, you know, having strong glutes before you do heavy deadlift. This culture of just going straight into it with full force without, you know, taking care of small things. At least the first 3 months, I feel, should be spent for at least, you know, bringing your body back to life.
Back to life. Yeah. Unlearning and relearning. See, we have learned so many things that are probably not good for us. Even work from home. So you sit and work in your bed. Your back is probably not straight at all.
Yeah.
So you there's a lot of unlearning that needs to be done. And then you have to relearn how to get correct posture. And also people give a lot of importance to reps. The number of reps. Mm. I can do so many reps. It doesn't matter. Can you do one rep with perfect posture? That's good. You did 3 reps with perfect posture, you're winning. I don't care you're doing like 15 reps or not. What is the point of you doing 15 reps if the posture was wrong all the while?
That is a person who has not done his research talking, right? Because you only rip your muscles to an extent that they can build again so that you can do that again. So that is the point of reps and so on. But the point is, like, you have to figure it out on your own is the best way, or take help of a trainer who does not shame you for your speed and so on, right? So one more thing is, like, what are your thoughts on, like, over glorification of weight loss? Do you have the entire Instagram is about, you know, showing your most beautiful self, and in our weird beauty standards, slim is beautiful, which is weird, right? So what can we do about this over glorification?
Okay, so I'm going to split this question into two. First one is the whole glam side of Instagram. Let's not be carried away by the glam side of Instagram. That is, as someone with so many thousand followers, I can tell you, we try to put the best out there. Like, we rarely show you what's not, like, the things that don't go work out our way. We only show you, obviously, because when somebody comes across our profile, we want them to, like, see, oh, this person, like, looks so good in this. So there is a glorification in Instagram, but that should be understood by people by now, because you know, we have been on Instagram for so long. You should know that's not real life. You are hardly seeing 15, 20, 1 minute of a person's life. So that's not the entire thing.
Yeah.
I have also made a reel on how people see. Like, people most of the time see my after workout pictures. Like, I pose. That is also, it's also posture. Like, how you pose. And as a model, I am very good at it. Like, I know my angles. Mm. I can pose in a way that will make you feel like, oh my god. But no, when I sit down, I still have rolls. That's normal. I'm human. So I have shown the behind the scenes also. When I was going through all the journey, like, sometimes I'm on the verge of tears. Like, I am sweating. So I recorded it. I know I couldn't use it then, but I knew one day I can look back at it and be very proud. So there is a reel on that as well. And that's, it's like what people see. People see all these very nice after workout pictures of mine. But what really happens is me, like, dying, almost on the verge of dying. So, yeah, that's there. And second, about glorifying weight loss. That I have a problem, okay? Like, that I think is totally, like, let's not call it glorifying weight loss. Let's call it glorifying my achievement. Like, I put in so much time and effort. Why should I not show off? Like, you see people showing off their iPhone 12s that they didn't buy, that their dad bought for them. Driving BMWs that they didn't work a single day to get because their dad or mom bought for them. When I worked on myself for one whole year, doing everything from scratch, of course I will glorify it. Like, I don't know why people need to, like, feel bad about somebody glorifying their achievement.
And it also feels that it feels good that you are gaining new strength, right? For example, when I started working out, I used to see my friends doing pull-ups at the drop of a hat, and I could not do a single pull-up, right? So the thing is, I researched how to build enough strength to have a pull-up. First of all, you have to have a good forearm, and then you work on your, lat rotation, scapular rotation, and then you get this movement right. And my first ever unsupported pull-up that I did, it just felt so good to reach to that point, right? It is a joy in itself. and to do get geeky about the research, right, is also a lot of fun. and to see that information come to life and come to fruition. And then I was like chugging 30 pull-ups just like that, right? So that is where I reached. The feeling of, you know, having enough strength to lift your own body weight is an amazing feeling for me to have, which I've never had before.
Exactly. The I feeling... felt that way about my first push-up.
Yeah. Exactly. Even push-up, I could not do barely 2-3. Now I can do reps and reps of it. And also something like the fact that you have strength to do 100 kilos of deadlift. It's a great feeling to have, right? And it's not an
achievement.
Yeah, it's not like we are trying to shame someone who's not achieving it. It's just that...
Who can't, yeah.
Yeah, that which is, you can't, which is absolutely fine. It doesn't make you anything less. It's just that I am happy to reach this place because I have worked on it, and it's just, I'm expressing my happiness on the social media, and I don't think there's anything wrong in it.
There's nothing wrong in it. And that's why earlier, before my Instagram blew up itself, I told, if by watching my stories, you feel bad about yourself, you should unfollow or you should mute my stories, because that is not my intention to make anybody feel bad. But if you feel like, oh my God, she's doing this, let me also work out today, or let me also, you know, get, you know, do some research on this workout or do some research on this nutrition, that's good. But if it makes you feel bad, then you should just
remove yourself from the situation. To tell about the fun of getting there, the fun of the process, reading something obscure on Google and seeing that tip work, which, you know, suddenly gave you strength to lift a 20 kilo dumbbell, right? Just the fun of the process is also something that people don't miss. People take it as a chore, you know, a routine, which it shouldn't be. It doesn't have to be like that if you really are interested about the science.
But I'm noticing it, people are lazy to read through that much. So my advantage was, I am in law school, right? I am so used to reading 1,000 pages judgments. You know, I am so used to reading these small texts. So for me, it was fun to read all these, science papers that are published by these Nutritional Institute of America and all of that. But for people, I don't know, some people just can't do it. They just prefer to do something. So most of my information came from these research papers, because I didn't want to just like that go on Google and see what somebody else told.
Yeah.
Research papers have numbers, right? So numbers, it has clear numbers. And if you still want better idea, then you have to go for research papers based on meta-analysis, which is the analysis of all the research papers. So it's not just research. So they take the research of that subject and then collate that information. So that's even better.
Yeah.
So yeah, there's a lot of time goes into it. Let's be real. But it's fun. Like, you will be like, really? Like, this is how you do it?
Yeah.
And you're knowledgeable. Like now... A year ago, I didn't have this much knowledge about food, about workout, nothing. But now I'm so knowledgeable. I don't have qualification. Like, I'm not certified, but that doesn't make me any less of a person when it comes to knowledge. Now, will I go around telling random people what they should do? No. Especially when it comes to food, you will never hear me give out anything, because I am not qualified to do that. But when it comes to workout, I can provide you as good of an information that like a personal trainer would, because what he went through studying is exactly what I went through as well. But I did it just for me, not like
certificate. Personal trainer is obviously much more qualified because he has gone through many scenarios, he's gone through many clients. So he has his advantage, and you can totally approach him. So Nimisha, before we end this podcast, right? So we have to talk about your content work. So what is there in the store for the future, right? So you have 10,000 followers on Instagram, you gained them in 8 months, and you obviously have the access to share the link. So are you going to start a YouTube channel? What are you going to do? What is your content planning? Career planning, attorney career, the career that happens with looks, the modeling
Instagram.
And so on. Yeah.
Okay. So right now we hit 12,000, I think some time ago it was 12.
Yeah.
So I can swipe up links. That's like a little bit of pride for me. Now I can do swipe up links. I've always wondered, like, I know the elite from nano, I just jumped into like a micro influencer level now.
Yeah.
So that's fun. So when it comes to content, I've had people ask me if this is going to completely shift to a fitness page, which I will not, unless something drastic happens and that's the decision I take. Currently, it will not shift to a fitness page, because that it restricts my creative idea to like only work on fitness when I have other things to work. Mostly this is my personal blog. Like this is my personal stuff. I will put out fitness content, but I will also put out fashion content and modeling content and all that. Career-wise, since you said not the attorney wala, but that is getting that degree next year, this time I graduate. So that is on top of the list.
Corona batch.
That is going to happen. Yeah, Corona. Can you imagine I've gone to law school for 4 months?
Sure.
That's it. That's it. I basically became a lawyer at home. I don't know how judges are going to take me seriously. They're like, oh, you studied at home, right?
Say it loud and clear and it'll be fine.
They're like, oh, you're the batch who studied from a computer. So that's happening. The law school thing is going to happen. Modeling thing, it's good. Like, I'm getting a lot of opportunities. A lot of shoots are lined up. But as of now, everything is put on hold because every other state is on lockdown. It's slowly opening up. So once it's opened up, I'm expecting by August, things will pick up in a much faster way. Yeah. I am getting approached for some movies. Like,
oh, shit.
But I'm still considering, like, it's still on talks. But it would be nice, right? Like, imagine. Like, why should it die? Like, let's see. But when it comes to influencing, this is a new territory for me. Like, I don't know how to navigate through this, but I am learning and
have an open mind. Just, you know, it's about, you know, there will be 90,000 trolls, but there'll be 10 people who'll tell something valuable that you'd never thought. Have you ever had this experience before on the, or you had some tip on the online that really helped you in the long run? Or because, you know, it's, there is a lot of trolling as well, but you get some good stuff, right? It's not as if everything is bad.
See, I know, like, I know that generally, like I said, at the beginning of this conversation itself, I told you cannot make everybody happy and that's okay. But sometimes you don't take your own advice, right? You have those days when you're like, oh my God, why? So on most times, like if you follow me, you know, I take it in a fun way. Like if people make fun of me, I make fun of them. Like that's it. Like I screenshot it and I don't like personally engage with them at all. So these are all messages that's fallen in the message request side, right?
Okay.
So I'm not personally going to engage with them because that's, I don't want to, but it's funny. So I'm like, okay, why should I just laugh on my own? Let everybody laugh with me. So that's how, and I leave it. I don't take it seriously at all. But sometimes, you know, sometimes I might be having a bad day and then I open and see a message that is so rude for no reason. Like, what am I doing? I am basically here just putting out some workout pictures, making some fun reels and, you know, showing my three dogs. Like, what? I'm not even talking about controversial stuff here.
Yeah.
Why do you have to spread this much hate to me? So you feel bad. Like, I also feel bad. I have those down days. But I talk it out with my friends and they reassure me that, you know, it's fine. It happens. You should get used to this by now. Because with a lot of traction comes a lot of hate as well. So you just learn to you know, adapt yourself and like you said, I'm keeping an open mind and seeing like where this is going to take me. And what you will never see is me selling detox teas and slimming teas. That never
Sell
no
science.
Amount of money can make me do
the
that.
the only thing that's worth selling is the science of it, just the just the words of like, do your thing, do what makes you feel good. So on that note, Nimisha, any final thoughts? Especially, I want to split this final thoughts into two. Like, for people who are working out, for people who don't want to work out, both are fine. I mean, you're nothing different. What you choose to do with your body doesn't define you.
Yeah. So my final thoughts on people who work out, keep doing. Keep doing. Like, you are not working out to prove anything to anybody.
Yeah.
You're working out because you feel good. The kind... like I might be having a bad day, but the minute I finish a workout, I am pumped. I'm ready to take on the day. And that feeling alone is more than enough for me to keep going on. For people who don't want to work out, you do you, boo. Like, it's totally fine. But who want to work on, but is trying and they're not able to because, you know, they don't have time, they have family to take care, they have work that comes in between, they just can't find motivation. Keep trying. Like, try. Do what I always say. This is like my biggest advice to people who want to work out. Just say yourself 15 minutes. That's it. You do not have to work out for 2 hours, 3 hours. 15 minutes, I will work out. And at the end of 15th minute, if I feel the same way, like if I feel bad, if I feel lazy, I'm going to stop. Because that's it. I tried and I couldn't. But I assure you, 90% of the times, by the time you reach that 15th minute, you will want to complete that workout. Because you will feel so good. You'll be like, you know what? Let me finish it. So if for the people who want to work out, say yourself 15 minutes. That's it.
Amazing thoughts, Nimisha. I hope you grow and grow and your message reaches out and you get a lot of love more than a lot of hate. And I really love your Instagram and what you do with your Instagram. Absolutely follow her on Instagram. If you can really quickly put out your socials where we can find you.
You can find me on Instagram at Legally Brunette. You are going to type it down, right? Because there are so many dots and underscores.
Yep, it'll be in the description.
Yeah.
Check this girl out for motivation, for message, for love, for entertainment. She's really funny as well. So that's it from our podcast. Thank you, Nimisha, for your time. Till we see you next time with another episode. Bye, everyone.